Good morning, and we are going on to agenda item 2, agenda item 1 is to agree to take item 4, consideration of evidence heard, and item 5, which is an informal briefing from the Scottish Government's UNCRC bill team in private, where we all agreed. Yes, we're all agreed. Thank you very much. Agenda item 2 is subordinate legislation. One negative Scottish statutory instrument, that is the SSI 2023-223, the Act of Sederant Summary Applications, Statutory Applications and Appeals, etc., Rules 1999 and Taxation of Judicial Expenses, Rules 2019, Amendment Telecommunications Infrastructure 2023. And I refer members to Paper 1 and note that there is no accompanying policy note or impact assessment for this instrument. Do members have any comments to make on this instrument? No member has indicated that they have any comments to make. That being the case, are members content formally not to make any comment to the Parliament on this instrument? Thank you, and that concludes the consideration of the instrument. Agenda item 3 is the pre-budget scrutiny 2024-25. And this is an evidence session which will take place. And this morning I would like to welcome Alexis Campbell, Policy Manager, and Mirren Kelly, Chief Executive, Local Government Finance, both representing COSLA this morning, and you are with us in the room. I'd also like to welcome Alan Foles, Senior Policy Officer, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, the Alliance, who is joining us remotely. Good morning. And Heather Williams, Training Lead, Scottish Women's Budget Group, who is also joining us this morning remotely. So I should also note that Danny Boyle, Senior Parliamentary and Policy Officer at BMIS, was also due to attend, but is now unable to do so. He has, however, indicated that he would look to provide evidence in writing. I would like to refer members to papers 2 and 3 and invite each of our witnesses to make a short, brief opening statement, starting with Alexis, please. Or Mirren?
I'm going to hand over to Mirren, thank you.
Absolutely fine.
and just to note, I'm not the chief executive, I'm the chief officer.
Thank you.
So firstly, thanks for inviting us to speak to the committee today. Local government is the anchor in our communities and for our most vulnerable groups. For children, young people and families, for the elderly and those needing extra support, and the most marginalised communities within Scotland. Also supporting businesses, for those needing help with housing, and for the services that protect and improve our physical and emotional well-being and the environment. Local government works with diverse communities and local organisations every day to bring about change, to respect human rights and equalities, to embed local democracy and enable the voices of people to be heard. Local authorities run budget consultations ahead of decisions being made that feed into the budget process, and local authorities regularly engage with marginalised groups to inform that decision making. Local government is indeed the key partner to achieving rights realisation across Scotland, and that's why local government requires a fair budget settlement. While local government has itself protected areas of the budget, such as social work and education, as much as possible, this means that cuts to other areas, such as culture and leisure, have been higher. And this has an impact on rights realisation and the well-being of our communities. Understanding the lived experiences within those communities we serve is a key element of what local government does. We need a holistic approach to the services delivered by local government: social care, education, housing, employability, leisure, transport, the local environment, as together they support the rights of the individual. The Verity House Agreement provides a platform to achieve this, setting out a clear focus on 3 key areas of tackling poverty, particularly child poverty, achieving a just transition, and having sustainable person-centred public services. Local by default and national by agreement is a key element from a rights perspective. There can sometimes be tension created by local decision-making and prioritisation, leading to perceived inconsistencies in service. This is not a postcode lottery. This is democratic decision-making informed by local voice, needs and rights. In addition to a fair settlement, Scottish Government should empower local government to raise revenue to ensure the maximum available resources can be used to support our communities. Positive steps have been taken in this direction with the continuing development of the fiscal framework, and we look forward to continue to work on that with Scottish Government. Scottish Government should therefore be using the opportunities of human rights budgeting to enable and empower the public sector to support rights realisation and avoid the regression of rights.
Thank you, Mirren, for that. I'd like to move on to Alan Foles, please.
Good morning. So I'm a senior policy officer at the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland. The Alliance is a national third sector intermediary for a range of health and social care organisations. We've got a membership of over 3,300, which includes third sector organisations, private and statutory sector bodies, and also individuals with lived experience both of receiving and providing health and social care services, working towards our vision of a Scotland where everyone has a strong voice and enjoys the right to live well with dignity and respect. I'm sure the committee are quite familiar with the Alliance by this point and on the specific subject of the budget, and we've been quite active in discussing a range of alternative approaches to budgeting in the economy, most notably on human rights budgeting, which I'll admit is the one we have a bit more...
Alan, sorry to interrupt you there. We seem to be getting a bit of feedback at our end. I think our technicians are just seeing if we can hear your voice a little bit clearer.
See any improvement there at all, or?
We've still got a bit of an echo there. Okay, Alan, if you could try again and just slow down just a little bit, see if that makes a difference.
Apologies. Yes, I have been told I've got the Glaswegian thing of talking just a touch too fast. Also, I'm aware technical issue is a long-standing problem by this point. Just to sort of pick up on my second paragraph, though I can see perhaps the convener, perhaps, is it still the sound a bit odd? Oh, sorry, I can't hear the room sound at the moment.
Alan, do you want to try again just now, please?
Yes. Is that any better at all?
That's fantastic. Thank you.
Cool. If I can, I will just start from the beginning then, just to sort of pick things up. So the Alliance National Third Sector Intermediary for a range of health and social care organisations. We've got membership of over 3,000, that's third sector organisations, private and statutory sector, and crucially, individuals with lived experience, both of receiving and providing health and social care. So the Alliance, we've got quite significant work around the area of alternative approach to budgeting and the economy, most notably on human rights budgeting, which I will admit today is the area we've got probably the most to say on. But we've also touched on areas such as gender budgeting, the caring economy and the wellbeing economy, both through our general policy work and through our Health and Social Care Academy programme, which has a specific focus on transformational approaches to health and social care. And one of the points that we have been making sort of ahead of pre-budget scrutiny for the past few years is the importance of recognising not just spend as part of our human rights budgeting approach, but also how we approach revenue raising to deliver on human rights.
Thank you. Thank you, Alan. And thank you for your patience as well. I'd like to move on to Heather Williams, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'm Heather Williams. I am the training lead for the Scottish Women's Budget Group. Scottish Women's Budget Group is a third sector membership organisation whose mission is to promote equality through the use of gender budgeting. Gender budgeting is about asking who benefits and who doesn't from how we raise money and how we spend money. It's not just about what is allocated, but about the impact of how money is spent or how it is raised, how it's actually raised has on individuals within society. And the aim of gender budgeting is to make the process and outcomes of policy making and gender and budget setting more transparent, equitable and participatory. Often, I think sometimes we get into a debate that gender budgeting and human rights budgeting are two different things. They're actually really complementary of each other. And we would argue that when we take a human rights budgeting approach, it's still essential to understand how gender stereotypes, norms and expectations impact create inequality for women and to ensure that these are taken into account. Without taking then we can fail to see how long-standing cultural norms and societal choices have created systemic barriers that shape decision-making and how those embed and entrench inequalities, particularly around things like violence against women and girls and caring, whether that's paid and unpaid, and how we value this. And in the areas mentioned in the Programme for Government and the Very House Agreement in relation to poverty, climate change, equality and opportunity, and the public sector, all of these have gender dimensions. And we would argue that, this isn't an either or of human rights budgeting or gender budgeting, but that both approaches need to be considered in decision making if we are to achieve a more fairer and equitable Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. Thank you very much. And thank you to all of our witnesses this morning to the 18th meeting of 2023 in session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. Those of you who have eagle eyes may have noticed I remiss to say that at the top of the meeting, but now it is on record which meeting this is. So we will move on to questioning, and I'd like to kick us off with Maggie, the Vice Convener, please.
Thanks very much, Co-Cabinet. Good morning to the panel, and thank you for joining us this morning and for putting up with the tech issues that we have. Thank you for your opening statements. I think it's quite clear that there are connections between gender budgeting and human rights budgeting. And across the committee, we're interested in the human rights budgeting approach that takes account of transparency, accountability and participation as tools for scrutiny, but also tools for those points that I think you all mentioned, how we raise, how we allocate, how we spend, and therefore what the impacts of our budgeting decisions are. So could I ask, and maybe Heather, I'll come to you first, if that's okay. You talked about gender budgeting and human rights budgeting being complementary. I'm wondering if you could say whether the principles that we're applying in human rights budgeting, how they can, do they capture what we need to be capturing when we're thinking about gender budgeting?
Thank you. So there are lots of similarities between human rights budgeting and gender budgeting. In terms of human rights budgeting, transparency, accountability and participation are key principles. These are also key principles of gender budgeting. And are really important in terms of how we go about making the decisions about how we raise money and how we spend money. Another important principle that I think is important for us to talk about when we're thinking about budgeting, and which is key to gender budgeting, is that it's performance and results orientated. So gender budgeting helps bring strategic planning and public finances closer together by linking policy targets and objectives more closely with budgets, and that promotes the most effective and efficient allocation and resources and implementation of policies. I think it's really important that we're able to see through the budget decisions what are we aiming to do when we raise this money or when we spend this money, and how actually does that happen in practice. So implementation and following the money is a really important principle of gender budgeting. I think another couple of principles which we would argue are really important, and that is that in gender budgeting, we argue that we need to take a lifetime perspective wherever possible. So about recognising that decisions that we may take now may impact negatively, particularly on women and at retirement age. So making sure we're taking that lifetime approach. And also that we really consider what do the decisions that we take mean for care, and particularly unpaid care. So for instance, local authority level at this year's budget, a few decisions have been taken around cuts to transport and community transport. And we would argue that we need to see what impact that has on care, because often that is carried out by women. It impacts on their ability to work, it impacts on their income and their the level of poverty that they're living in or not. So we need to take that into account. And the other principle within gender budgeting that's really important is that often we, when we see impact assessments, is they get, we get told that there is no there's no difference, or we aren't aware of any difference in terms of the different protected characteristics. And that's often because there's no data or because we've not analysed the data. We would argue that when we are making decisions because of the differences in how men and women often live their lives, particularly around those responsibilities for care, is that actually we should be starting from the position that there will be a different impact until we have the evidence to show that there's not, rather than starting off the other way around where we say there's no evidence to show that there will be a different impact. We should actually be assuming that there likely is because of the impact that those norms and stereotypes have on how people live their lives. Hope that answers your question.
That's really helpful, Heather, and it gives us quite a few different angles and perspectives to think about. But your point, I think, about data there is well made, and I know others will probably want to pick up on that, so I won't drill down too much into that. But I know Alan wants to come in on this as well.
Yes, thank you. Just sort of a very brief addition, because I think Heather's got significantly more sort of expertise in this area than myself. But one thing that stands out in terms of the gender budgeting approach that's a really useful principle is the intersectional nature of it. So looking not just at the fact, you know, how women are affected, but how women are in different with different characteristics are affected. So whether that's ethnic minority, and whether they're LGBTI plus, you know, age, and whether they're working class, more affluent, these kind of things also have significant sort of impacts on how budgetary decisions impact women. So taking that intersectional approach has been quite a sort of important aspect of it as well, I would say.
Thanks, Alan. Could you unpick that a little bit? And I suppose one of the challenges or one of the questions we have is around where different intersectional categories might be perceived to come into conflict with each other, and how what would be the Alliance's approach to teasing those out in terms of the broader human rights budgeting approach?
Oh, so that's an easy question.
Yeah.
I suppose, like, general terms, we'd sort of tend to say that we don't see sort of human rights as being sort of in conflict, they're complementary. In terms of how we sort of tease some of these things out, if you give me a second just to think about it, I suppose okay. It's a bit early in the morning, and come back to me in a second.
Okay, no, that's fine. Sorry, I realise that is quite a big question. Whilst you're thinking, Mirren and Alexis, if I can come to you. Mirren, in your opening remarks, you talked about that balance, that agreement, and I think as somebody who believes in subsidiarity, local by default, national by agreement, how do you deal then with a rights-based approach where there's hopefully a universal application, a universal experience, and or at least a universal intent? How do you balance that kind of universality with the need for local decision-making? Yeah.
I think that does boil down to one of the key challenges, and it's how do you balance rights rather than have them compete or conflict with each other, and how do you enable the public sector and everyone else to get together to build that rights realisation? Because realistically, the challenge is that different parts of the country, different places, different individuals have different needs, but that doesn't mean that they have different rights. Mm-hmm. But in a time of limited resources, which we're all in, there are really difficult decisions on which rights you might have to focus on building that realisation towards. So the real challenge from a local authority perspective, given, you know, the plethora of services and that we're involved in delivering, how do you balance that? And that's genuinely that's a difficult question that councillors have to wrestle with when it comes to deciding on budgets kind of throughout the process. And I think one of the key things for achieving that is to enable everyone to have that increased kind of training and capacity building, which I'll let my colleague Alexis mm-hmm. speak to in a bit more detail, so that people understand the decisions that they're making, the evidence as is used as best as possible, and that people don't perceive it as conflicting. Mm-hmm. So they're getting that, which means I'm not getting this. That's one of the real tensions. And you get that, you know, you see that in an individual level, community level, regional. And so it is a challenge, and how we work our way through that, because we don't have unlimited resources, and we're not, you know, not everyone has their rights realised in the way that we would like, but that is different in different places.
Okay. Alexis, did you want to come in on the training?
Yes, thank you. So I just wanted to pick up on what Miriam was saying about the need for for capacity building across the local government sector to ensure that rights are being respected and the decisions that are being made take into account the needs of the local community whilst taking into account obviously the overarching frameworks that exist. I think this very clearly links to the Human Rights Bill that's currently out for consultation. Because there's responses being hopefully approved by convention this week, but something that our politicians have been very clear about in looking at the proposed new framework for human rights in Scotland is the real need for capacity building across local authorities to support staff to understand what rights are and how to balance rights and have those, those conversations that Miriam was talking about, where you might need to prioritise particular services, and you might need to have those difficult conversations. But in constrained financial times, you might not be surprised to hear me say that, a lot of this will come down to funding, in that local authorities do an awful lot under increasingly constrained circumstances, and there's a real willingness within the sector to get this right in terms of human rights budgeting and taking a rights-based approach, but particularly with the bill coming down the line, there are massive resource and workforce implications for councils that we'd like to highlight. One other thing I suppose I'd like to mention to build on what Miriam said about having those difficult decisions and sort of balancing rights and linking to the question that you asked, Alan, is about the opportunities for greater alignment of services, so that intersecting identities, intersecting needs can be addressed, with particular services. So, for example, my policy area that I focus on is in employability, and it's that's a policy area that obviously cuts across an awful lot of local government work. And there's, I think, more that can be done to explore the way that services can have a wider impact than just, essentially what it says, what it does on the tin. And, particularly with the Verity House Agreement and the focus on child poverty, that's meant there have been lots of discussions with COSLA, with local authorities and with Scottish Government colleagues about how services such as employability can have an impact in tackling child poverty, and how that work can be more widely spread amongst local government colleagues to ensure that the right people are getting the support.
Okay. Thanks, Alexis. If I can come back to Alan briefly, then just on that question around intersectionality, and I suppose maybe to focus it back to the budgeting question that we were asking, what are your thoughts about teasing out both the differences and the distinctions, but also ensuring that it's a balance rather than pitting different communities or individuals against each other in terms of rights. Thanks, Alan.
So I think the point that Miriam made earlier about resources sort of sparked something in me, which is about sort of offering choice to people. So something we've kind of heard repeatedly at the Alliance is about, for example, something that's really basic, a basic human right, is your access to food, and particularly food through social care, which is that, are we making sure that there is the choice there in the budget there for sort of culturally appropriate foods to be offered? So you've heard, people being offered just sandwiches as a thing, but is that culturally appropriate for every group? Is that what they're expecting to receive? So sort of building that kind of choice into budget processes, it's not just a case of can we get sort of the cheapest thing available and giving the same thing to everyone. And similarly, how do we deliver things like social care in a way that sort of respects the differing cultural norms in the provision of care? And how do we do that in a way that sort of both ensures that the person who's accessing that care gets the support they deserve to participate in society? Disabled people have a right to equal participation in society and to independent living. How do we deliver that whilst also at the same time sort of respecting what might be different cultural norms around the provision of care through extended families? So I suppose that's maybe not like the most detailed example, but was kind of just something that sort of briefly sparked in terms of these sort of differences, you know, that there are, maybe have different cultural groups, you know, different age groups who might approach delivery of care slightly differently in Scotland.
Okay, thanks. There's quite a lot in all of those answers, but I'll leave it there for now.
Thanks, Kirk. That is Maggie. Thank you. I think we've had a good shot at that one. I know that Heather wanted to come in just very briefly, Heather, just to finish off Maggie's line of questioning, please.
Sorry, apologies. My IT is a bit glitchy. So in terms of that question about how we balance those different rights, I think part of it is about what are priorities. You know, gender budgeting is very much about using data and about thinking about who is it that's most disadvantaged in our communities, and what does that look like, and who is it that we're trying to best support and best who needs the support. Using the data to identify what are priorities, what are targets, what are we trying to achieve, and that should then be driving the budget, rather than what we often have at the moment, which is we have budgets and we have equalities and for me equality impact assessments, which often sit out there, and very rarely do the two ever really meet properly. And we would argue that if we are taking a gender budgeting approach, or even a human rights budgeting approach, then we use the data to identify who are the most disadvantaged within our communities, and what do we need to do to make sure that their human rights are met. Because if we're doing that, then we will on all accounts most likely design services and deliver services that meet the needs of majority of people. But I think we have things a little bit back to front at the moment, and that we don't take into account the user qualities data and think, set targets and think about what is it we're actually trying to achieve and what budget decisions need to follow through to enable that to happen. And that's sometimes where that lack of transparency comes in as well, whether that be at national or local level in terms of decision making.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for that, Heather. Moving on to myself, and I'll be followed by Annie, will come in after me. The Scottish Government has said that the committee scrutiny process is key to providing accountability in the budget process. And with that in mind, can the panellists comment on whether they feel that this is the most effective approach to ensure that the Scottish Government's human rights obligations are met? So I'll go with Mirren first, and then I'll go to Alan, and then Heather. It'd be good to hear your comments as well. So Mirren, please, what's your perspective on whether this is the most effective way?
I think it's a tricky one, isn't it? Because I think it's a question to everyone on how much opportunity does the committee approach give you to influence the budget, because that's the key bit. If it's successful in terms of the scrutiny, then you've had the ability to influence and make changes. So certainly COSLA, we put evidence into most committees during the pre-budget, and we come to participate when we're invited, and we hope that leads to the discussion and decisions and information that does make changes and does take into account kind of the issues that are raised within that. But it can be potentially difficult to see where the change in decision is, just because of the way it is. Like we're talking about the pre-budget scrutiny evidence. We don't have, you know, a draft budget that we're trying to influence. Which I think it's really positive to have these conversations before decisions are taken, but they need to then actually feed in and influence the change before that comes in.
Thank you for that. Alan?
Yeah, so I think that committee scrutiny is obviously valuable, and it's got that kind of institutional support in terms of clerking and reporting, which is sort of invaluable, but it might be quite narrow in scope. You know, I'm sure that obviously the committee does aim to hear from a broad range of voices. The reality of committee evidence is probably that it's always going to come from sort of the expert or voluntary sector contributors, rather than hearing about those on the ground impacts of the budget. And I think one of the things that we know about sort of humans in general is sort of the power of stories, and it can still be relatively easy to dismiss sort of the negative human rights impacts of budget decisions when it's kind of seen as statistical or anecdotal, like we've seen, for example, the very significant negative impacts of the UK government's welfare reforms, and those have been catastrophic on your women, children and disabled people. But if you're only hearing about that in a kind of anecdotal and statistical way, it's not necessarily as powerful as having someone come in and hear directly from them individually about how they've been impacted. And I suppose the question is, you know, can you get that kind of evidence in the kind of formal and sometimes slightly intimidating setting of a committee evidence session? And it's not that, you know, MSPs are intimidating to me, and I think you'll be relieved to hear that I don't think the general public are frightened of you either, but it is that kind of, like, it is this kind of formal setting where you might be feeling like you need to talk or dress in a way that's different to how you normally do. So it might be quite sort of put in a way that it's not necessarily comfortable or natural for you to communicate. And so, you know, is there perhaps a way for, you know, more targeted engagement that's in a less formal way? So I'm very much not offering the alliances service here. I don't think I've been sent with the right to do that, but we do often do engagement work on behalf of the Scottish Government to hear directly from people with lived experience. You know, is that the kind of thing that perhaps through other organisations that the committee could go through to, you know, hear these sort of, in a smaller way, direct stories from people, perhaps, you know, taking pre-recorded video evidence, the kind of thing that people might be able to do at home on their smartphone to hear directly from those people. You know, just some of the things I've been thinking about in terms of committee scrutiny is useful and it's good, but it is very formal. And how do we hear about that more sort of direct lived experience?
Yeah, thank you for that, Alan. I do take your point on widening our sort of inclusion of voices that we hear. And just for your interest, we are trialling a model of citizens' participation panel, which we've started that process, and that is going well at the moment, and we're getting some good feedback from citizens sort of directly from their communities. So that is in the offing, but we will take note of some of your suggestions. Very helpful, thank you. Can I bring Heather in, please?
Thank you. So in terms of from a gender budgeting approach, we see kind of three stages to the budget process and how scrutiny can happen. So there's the ex-ante phase, which is prior to the budget setting. There's that concurrent phase, we'll draft and deciding on and executing the budget. And then there's the ex-post, which is when we're auditing and reporting on the budget. And I suppose for us, the committee, similar to Alan, we would say committee scrutiny is important, but we would ask questions about what happens with that scrutiny, how does that make its way into the budget process. And as Mirren says, it is really important that people who participate and given information actually find out, what are you doing with it? What have I said? What difference has it made? Or we end up thinking, well, there's no point in me taking part in it. So there's that bit. I think one of the bits that we would really focus on that we think is missing is that ex post, is what happens after the budget's set. So actually, you know, so the budget process happens, and then what happens next? There's very little, we would say it's very difficult to follow the money. So what happens when money is provided for an area such as social care, to health, to for public transport? Where does it go? What outcomes do we get from it? And how do we know that it's been spent in the way that it was intended? And that's one of the bits that we would say is missing. It's an important part of that kind of gender budgeting process, and in terms of following that money, seeing it as a circular process, that we use the data and we set our targets, what we're trying to do, we set our budgets, and we then follow the money to see what happens. And then we then use the data that we're capturing to set other targets and to try and achieve better outcomes and efficiencies, basically. And I think in terms of the way in which our budget processes work, both at national and at local government level, there are real difficulties in being able to do that because of that, often that that conveyor belt and the short timescales and things like that we're on. So I think we need to make our processes, rather than one-off consultations, it needs to be more of a regular ongoing basis, where rather than going out with a budget consultation, it's actually, what is it about those priorities and targets and what is it we're trying to do, which then feeds into the budget again. I think, yeah,
a cycle, a continuous sort of scrutiny cycle. Yeah, that's interesting. Yes. Thank you for that. I think some of the points that the panellists have mentioned, I think, lead very well onto my colleague Annie's line of questioning. Annie, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. And I think Heather and the convener knocked the nail on the head there when they said it's got to be a continuous cycle. Because my question was going to be, when do you feel that your participation is of most value? During the budget setting, during the budget scrutiny, or indeed the outcomes of past decisions? So I think you've kind of answered that question. I think all members have answered that question for us. So I'll just pop on to my second part of my question. Basically, where should the responsibility lie for enabling participation and ensuring that the process is accessible and meaningful? And I think this probably goes back to Alan's point here as well. This might include education around the budget process and providing data to support people engaging. So again, like the citizens' participation, how do we encourage more people with lived experience to come and give evidence? And I know you gave us a bit of an example, Alan, so I'll pop back to yourself if you don't mind.
Yeah, so I think that there's a bit of a role for both the Scottish Government and for the Parliament and its committees in terms of sort of enabling participation. I don't think there's a sort of responsibility lies with one side or the other. I think in our evidence last year in pre-budget scrutiny, that one of the points we'd kind of made was around about what kind of resources the government could make available in terms of budget. You know, it's not just publishing the budget and going, here you go, here's a 90 page long PDF, have at, but instead perhaps, you know, can they do sort of a multimedia engagement? So can they get, for example, cabinet secretaries, who I know are very, very busy people, but can they do, you know, say, cut a short 5-minute video on, you know, here are the things that the budget is going to achieve within my portfolio area, and here's the kind of policies it's going to sort of deliver and live up to. Can we do that kind of thing that sort of puts more sort of easy to access bite-sized information about what the budget is and how it's going to impact people's lives, how it intends to impact people's lives out there? And I suppose Parliament can do a sort of similar thing, and I kind of touched on that idea of, you know, can we get, as parliamentary evidence, can we get sort of short videos perhaps from individuals? Can people, you know, be asked to sort of fill out, you know, surveys that are perhaps less formal? And I would actually note that the pre-budget scrutiny survey this year was actually quite, I could see it was sort of, there was an attempt there to direct that at sort of kind of all levels, like the questions were sort of a bit sort of understanding and sort of phrased in quite a simple way. So I think there has been sort of progress there in sort of trying to make the sort of pre-budget scrutiny survey at least a bit less sort of formal and sort of less verbose. So I suppose some quick thoughts there.
Perfect. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that. Alexis, okay. Yeah.
Sorry, I wasn't sure if I needed to press the thing. Thank you. I suppose very briefly, I wanted to reflect on the fact that, as Alan said, yeah, there's certainly a role for Scottish Government and for the Scottish Parliament in enabling participation. But there's a lot of really good work going on at a local level, both from local authorities, but also within the third sector. Around participation, be it participatory budgeting or lived experience panels, feeding into local employability partnerships, or all of the other things that will, you know, be happening in your constituencies. I suppose it's really just to make the point about coming back to the principles of the Verity House Agreement and that sort of placing the decisions around local need sort of really within the hands of people within that area. I think there's a lot of learning to be taken from work that's already ongoing, but actually existing networks that could already be tapped into. And I don't necessarily mean the same people, because we don't want to have, you know, consultation fatigue and the same faces, you know, always asked. But particularly on, you know, on participatory budgeting, there's been, you know, such good work that's been happening, you know, in local authorities there. Could there be work that could be models of that, that could be applied, you know, for the budget process? But again, I'd like to come back to the fact that that would also require, you know, resourcing and capacity building, also actually a bit of investment in workforce and staff to actually support people. So my concern would be if this were done without any sort of additional resourcing and that capacity building, be that training or extra staff, that people might feel that they weren't fully supported to participate and, you know, could potentially be put off. So it does come down to, you know, tapping into what's happening locally, but also thinking about whether additional funding, additional resources are needed to support that to expand.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I think that Heather would like to come in, and followed by Alan. If I could encourage people to be as succinct as possible, because I have colleagues that have a range of questions and you might be covering some of those already. But nevertheless, Heather, please.
Okay, just very quickly, I suppose in terms of participation, one of the things that's really important is that we know who we're hearing from and who we're not. Often, particularly with online consultations that we've seen around budget processes, is that there's no demographic data asked. And we do know that there is a, for women in particular, for minority ethnic groups, that the word budget can put people off. Often it's that thing of that idea that women don't do numbers. How often, in terms of those kind of stereotypes that are out there, it's nonsense, obviously, but it is a stereotype that's out there, and it can impact on people thinking, is this something that's for me, or is this not something that's for me? And I think we need to be really, when we're talking about participation and hearing from different groups, is that we need to make sure we are doing that, and that we know who we're hearing from and who we're not. Having online consultations that don't ask demographic details, because that should be a basic consultation. If that's the limit of what we're doing, we need to know who we're hearing from and who we're not. We would obviously argue that we need wider consultations, similarly to Alan, but that would be a minimum that we ask that question: whose voices are we hearing and whose voices aren't we hearing?
Alan, please.
Yes, just very briefly, and a point Alexis made about participatory budgeting, it sort of sparked a quick thought in me, which is that it's just to re-emphasise a point the committee may have heard before, but if we're inviting people to participate in the budget process, and particularly in budget setting, they need to be given meaningful options and control, and not just, like, for example, handed a list of cuts and asked to pick between them. Participation has to be meaningful, and it's not about passing perhaps difficult decisions onto the public and going, well, cuts have to be made, but we'll let you guys decide. It has to be more meaningful than that.
Thank you, Alan. I just have a quick supplementary for our COSLA representatives. I'm glad that you mentioned the good practice that is going on, especially around participatory budgeting, and I know that that has benefited many constituencies, including my own. Could you give the committee some examples of how you capture how effective that has been, how meaningful local constituents, the people who are part of that process, how do you gather that feedback?
So the best person to answer that is the policy manager who leads on the participatory budgeting within COSLA. So councils themselves will be collecting that and collating that, and I believe there's an annual report on that. So what I can do is go and find where that is and share that with the committee after.
That would be brilliant. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'd like to move on to my colleague Fulton, who would be followed by Karen. Fulton.
Hey, thanks, Convener. And my line of questioning, I suppose, follows on from where we were there, particularly Heather's remarks that we just heard there. Because we do know that in this committee's heard a lot of times that there are particular groups who are most impacted by budgeting decisions and who also most rely on public services, so disabled people, BME people, and women. What more do you think the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament can do to make sure that their voices are heard? I know we've talked a wee bit about this, and you've heard from the convener about something that committee's trialling, which so far looks to be doing well, but have you got any other ideas about how both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament as a whole can make sure that all voices are heard in the process? I'm quite happy with any order. Maybe start with those in the room, Alexis or Mirren.
Yeah, I think some of this has been touched on. It is one of the things that Heather said is key. It's identifying the voices that you're not hearing some of the time, because there are lots of people who are articulate and motivated and, maybe shout the loudest. So having the information that helps you identify who you haven't heard from is a really key one. And then there are, local authorities have a lot of experience of going into quite difficult to reach communities. The third sector has a lot of experience of doing that. And I think quite often it's about it's about enabling the conversation to be brought to them rather than expecting them to bring it to you, so that we can all then benefit and have a conversation as equals as well.
Yeah, thanks, Mum.
Heather would like to come in.
Thank you. I suppose it's that old community development worker approach, isn't it, in terms of, you know, we talk about hard to reach communities, but is it that the communities are hard to reach or hard to reach groups, or actually is it that we don't listen well enough in terms of how we actually gather our information and who we gather information from and how we we disseminate that. So I think it is about, you know, using those kind of community development worker approaches. For instance, we've been working with a women's group in the Fosside area, East Lothian, and we had a room in the town, so we set up a gazebo and some chairs, and we got folks to come and talk to us about cost of living and how that's impacting on them. We've been working with Glasgow Disability Alliance. We got a group of disabled women together again to talk to us about their experiences. And it is that sometimes, you know, expecting people to come to us to give us their information. As you know, for some people, their lives are so difficult and hard enough. They're barely surviving, particularly at the moment, with the cost of impact of the cost of living crisis on the back of the COVID pandemic and things like that. So it's about tailoring your approaches to those different groups. But I think also, you know, lived experience is a big buzzword at the moment. But it's, if you're going to do it properly, it's difficult to do, and it has to be resourced, both for the people doing it, but also for the people taking part as well. And there needs to be that feedback loop. There's no point in asking people if we're not going to tell them what we're doing with it, even if it's to go back to them to say, actually, do you know what? Good suggestion, but we're not able to do that at the moment because of A, B, and C. Or we've decided we're not going to do that at the moment because of A, B, and C. We need to make it a communication, a conversation, rather than extractive, basically. It would be some of the things that I would say.
Thank you. Right. Thanks for that, Heather. And I suppose that brings me on to my kind of follow-up question. You've had a good way of predicting where I'm going today, Heather. But I think that a lot of the times, I think the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government is quite kind of high-level stuff. And even the engagement we do in here, it's talking about national scales. I think that was a really good example there. But I wanted to ask, how can the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government get more right into the actual decisions that affects people? So, for example, in North Lanarkshire, my local area just now, there's a lot of talk about shutting down of libraries and swimming pools and stuff like that. And there's going to be big debates over that over the next few weeks as that kind of airs a bit more. But how do we get people that we've spoken about there to hear their views on these things, the actual, you know, impact? You know, what more can the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament? Because even today's discussion, up until probably the Fault House example, there has been quite a high level discussion. It's been at, you know, it's been up here. It's been at Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government level. What about the stuff that's actually impacting people on the ground? Does anybody get any ideas of what we can do more on that to let people's voice be heard here? I'm happy for Aaron to come in.
I think of that, though, it's really important that we respect the joint spheres of government between local government and Scottish Government. And it is really challenging to consider some of these things and the challenging budgets that we have. I do very much hope that the Verity House Agreement will enable a greater kind of mutual understanding and a greater mutual process. And kind of, you know, and seeing where everyone is there, and that assurance and accountability, again, a mutual assurance and accountability, so that everyone does understand the consequences of budgetary decisions and actually how they then filter down and what that means at a local level and at a minute level as well. I'll pause.
Thank you for that. Thank you. I'd like to bring in Karen, and Karen will be followed by Paul.
Thank you, Convener. Just to try and pull some examples, if you can, and that's possible, just to paint a picture, really, and where you feel that mainstreaming hasn't worked to tackle inequalities and reach human rights aspirations, and if you think that participation in those particular areas would have helped to gain a better understanding of the impacts of policy making and would have made a difference. And I'm happy to take whoever wants to come in.
Heather, for that one, please. It's indicated she wants to speak.
Thank you, Karen. I suppose one of the ones for us that's really clear in terms of where we are failing to address inequalities or human rights aspirations is around care. You know, care provision has been affected by COVID, but we haven't to need care, but also impacts on those who are having to pick up those unmet care needs, which is primarily women. And the surveys that we've ran this year, both the national survey that...
Apologies, Heather, you're breaking up a wee bit there. Heather, we're not able to hear you just now. I'll come back to you and I'll bring in Alan.
Yes, I think I'm potentially going to make perhaps one of the points that Heather might have gone on to make if tech wasn't our enemy this morning. But just to say that in social care, there are significant inequalities that haven't yet been fully addressed. A particular issue recently has been the ongoing issue of non-residential care charging. So the Scottish Government have committed to abolish those charges, but progress on that has been slow. And they have increased significantly in recent months, I think a figure of 60% in Glasgow. And that these kind of increases for care charging are having a serious impact on people's ability to access their right to independent living and to equal participation in society. Another area where I think there's perhaps a useful interplay between human rights budgeting and gender budgeting would be sort of issues around social security. There's a human right to social security in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights itself. And we know that women are more likely to have some or all of their income coming from the social security system. That can be due to inequality from lower rates of pay, because as Heather was saying, that the responsibility for care, whether social care or childcare, continues to fall mostly on women, which can reduce earning potential. So the Scottish Government has a lot of welcome investments in both social care and social security that is really, really good, and it is genuinely making a significant difference. But it hasn't. There are still areas where it hasn't gone far enough, where there needs to be more work to do this. I suppose it's an easy thing for the third sector to say that's not constrained by just going, oh, well, financial situation is tough. Recognising that, well, if the financial situation is tough, but these are essential services delivering on human rights and addressing inequalities, what is the approach you take to revenue raising? How do you raise the revenues to deliver these essential services? And that goes perhaps all the way back to the very start when Mirren or Alexis was saying about ensuring that local government, for example, has a fair funding settlement, because so many of these services are delivered by local councils.
Thank you for that, Alan. We're going to try with Heather again. I think, Heather, you're going to switch your camera off to see if we can hear you more effectively. We'll have a go.
Yeah, apologies about that. So hopefully you can hear me okay?
We can, thank you.
Wonderful, brilliant. Alan's made a lot of the points that I was going to make in relation to an area where I think there are still huge issues, and that is around care. All of the surveys that we've done this year has raised issues in relation to decisions that have been taken either by health and social care partnerships, by local authorities and by health boards in relation to social care and childcare, whether that be early years, that have had a negative impact on primarily the women that we have surveyed. And we know that in relation to kind of social care, and Alan's mentioned it in relation to charging, that has a real negative impact on those who on disabled people. But I think also, looking at one of the things that we carried out earlier this year was we looked at the the budget papers available for local authorities, and in the publicly available information, there were not all local local authorities published either equality impact assessments or integrated impact assessments of the decisions that they were taking in relation to cuts to either your early years or around raising charges. And similarly, in relation to decisions taken by the Scottish Government, it's not always clear to be able to see about the equalities considerations that have been taken around decisions. So while we talk about mainstreaming, in terms of practice, in terms of thinking about the impact either on specific groups or on the impact that it will have on other service areas, we're not actually very good potentially, or as good as we think we are at doing that in practice. And when we're in the particular financial situation that we're at the moment, both at a Scottish Government and at a local government level, it's even more important that we are actually doing that and are really clear about the impact of decisions to either raise charges or to cut costs, and the impact that that's going to have, so that mitigations can be put in place if required. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Paul, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I suppose I've got the last kind of few questions, so I'm keen to try and pull together the themes we've been discussing, and a lot of this has come up already, but transparency is obviously a key issue in terms of people being able to make an informed contribution to budget consultation processes. And I suppose I'm particularly interested in, you know, we as a committee want to look at transparency in more detail in the next budget process, but I'm keen to understand to what extent a lack of data or a lack of accessible data hinders people's participation. Now, I think we've heard that kind of woven throughout the answers this morning, but, you know, is there any particular data that's missing, or any could we make data more accessible essentially for people?
Yeah. I think with that, it's not always that the data isn't available, but there isn't necessarily the capacity and time to do the analysis and then apply that in the decision process in the most meaningful way. And so I think that local authorities have been making difficult decisions about budgets for a lot of time, and sometimes questions are like thrown a bit sort of disparagingly about back office staff and what they're doing. That's where the deepest cuts have been. There's been huge reduction over the last decade of what's viewed as back office staff, but a lot of those are people who maybe 10, 15 years ago might have been the ones who had the time then to analyse some of the data and to provide a more, a more comprehensive and view of some of that. So that there's a capacity issue around that, I think, because certainly local authorities have a lot of data. We generate a lot of data. We report into Scottish Government in hundreds of different ways. But there is absolutely, and you know, these discussions sort of come up around the National Performance Framework and how you measure. How you measure that, and measuring outcomes is always a tricky bit of like it. I don't think there's necessarily a lack of data, but there's maybe a lack of the ability to utilise that data in a meaningful way that allows all of us to make the informed decisions and then scrutinise the success of what we do with resources. So.
Thank you, Miriam. Can I bring in Alan, please?
Yeah, so just one of the points the Alliance has repeatedly made, and, you know, in a number of consultations in a lot of areas, just is about the importance of collecting comprehensive, intersectional and disaggregated data. And I'm possibly going to very slightly contradict Mirren there, just in the sense that for particular groups, for like minorities of the population, that might be where we don't currently have data. So thinking about at social care, which is obviously one of the key areas for the Alliance, we have a lot of data on social care more generally. But as we discovered through our My Support, My Choice research about self-directed support that we did with Self-Directed Support Scotland a number of years ago, there's a particular paucity of data around people from minority ethnic backgrounds and from the LGBTI plus community, what their experiences of social care are and whether or not social care was meeting their needs. And that's the kind of thing where if we don't have that data, then we don't know what's happening in terms of delivery, service delivery for those groups. And that's therefore somewhere where, you know, being able to get more participation from those groups might help in the understanding. And I think that especially when we're talking about those particular groups I've highlighted, so minority ethnic groups and LGBTI plus people, those can be seen as such small minorities of the population that when it comes to sort of statistics and gathering information, it's easy to brush it off as, oh, these findings aren't statistically significant, which then sort of compounds that difficulty in sort of understanding how minority groups are being affected. So we need to sort of, we need to take a more serious and more sort of comprehensive approach to gathering that data, and not just sort of brush it off with, well, it's small minority, so it's hard to do. Well, they may be a small minority, but they matter.
Thank you. I think that was both exchanges there were helpful in terms of understanding, I think, the importance of that. I mean, my next question is about barriers, and I suppose many of the groups that we've spoken about this morning are represented by organisations in a kind of broader sense, but often there can be barriers to getting to, you know, everyone's point of view. So I think as a committee, we're keen to understand, you know, what do you feel those barriers are to people feeling they're part of a representative voice, essentially, and how might we address that better? You know, how might we get to the root of people's issues?
Heather would like to come in, I believe. Yeah, I'm trying to keep an eye on virtual
Thank you. I mean, I think one of the things for me in this is that we talk about transparency, but I think there's a lot of kind of misunderstanding and misinformation at times about kind of how money's raised and what money's used for, and about taxation and benefits. And by benefits, I mean the services that the public service deliver and provide to society generally. And I think, you know, that can be coloured by lots of different things you know, in terms of how people perceive that. But I think, you know, in terms of that conversation, we probably need to be able to have a really clear conversation at whatever level about that, about what it is to, you know, because at the moment within the UK and Scotland, we have this expectation of Scandinavian level services, but at US levels of taxation. And those two don't mix, you know, there are issues. But we also, within our, you know, when we think about how we measure success in terms of our economy, we talk about carers as being economically inactive. Nobody's economically inactive. You know, if we're buying things, we are contributing to the economy. So there are lots of different things, I think, in terms of that how we have that conversation and the things that we need to be able to talk about with people about what the budget process is, because it's not just about spending money, it is about how we raise money. And in terms of the impact to that on different groups, we need to be considering that as well. But there's a, I think, you know, in terms of the citizens' participation stuff that you have talked about, part of it about how we have those conversations with groups and how we make it relevant to different groups is really important. And to terms of equalising that and sharing that, you know, these are the decisions that we're having to make and this is why we're having to make them, but doing that in an easily accessible and understandable way so that we're taking people with us as much as possible. And if decisions are made that people don't agree with, they at least understand why that's being taken. I think often, you know, sometimes these decisions can get, and the reasons for them can get at local and national level, can get lost in the kind of hubbub of politics at times and the hot air that can sometimes be kind of generated through that kind of adversarial approach that there sometimes is. So we need to get better at communicating about this whole process and make it more easily, you know, accessible for people because it impacts on them and we need to take them with us, I suppose, as Kenny. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Heather. Can I bring Alexis in, please?
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to pick up on something that Heather mentioned in an answer to a previous question about the importance of a community development approach. And I think this is something that's particularly pertinent to this question. Because if we're asking people to share their experience and to sort of grapple with potentially sort of tricky or complicated issues and the potential impact of spending decisions, I think you really need to have really trusted relationships. You need to have staff, I would say this from a local government perspective, who you have the resourcing for staff who are trained, who can support people to meaningfully participate and actually are able to engage in appropriate ways with communities that maybe have felt that there are barriers to them participating or have felt excluded. Because it really is a process that's really built on trust, particularly if we're asking people to give, to share their lived experience, to share their opinion, to share something that's happened to them, and linking back to the feedback loop, it all sort of ties into having the resourcing for that to be properly supported.
Thank you. Alan?
Yeah, so I think in terms of barriers to organisations representing groups, I think fundamentally it comes down to time and resource. Obviously, people need time to participate and they need the resources to do so. And that includes, for example, being able to pay staff to enable that participation and also funding for any sort of access needs. So, for example, if it's in person, you know, perhaps travel expenses for people to come along and to participate, assistive technologies that they might require. And particularly for sort of third sector organisations, you know, who are supporting these groups, for example, disabled people's organisations or, you know, think citizens' advice bureaus. You know, the situation right now is just so tough in terms of stretched finances for the third sector that they might just not have the capacity at all to enable that kind of participation. They don't have the funds to do support for people beyond their core service delivery, and sort of perhaps engaging in participative budgeting processes would be almost be like an additional area of work that they just don't have the time, the capacity, the money to engage in. So I think that's really quite key.
Thank you. Paul, are you... Yep,
yes,
are you
concluded? Camilla, thank you.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you very much. So that concludes the formal... yes. Yep, that concludes the formal part of the business this morning. Can I take the opportunity to thank all my colleagues for their patience and our panellists with regards to the tech issues, but I think we managed very well. I'd also like to thank you for your contributions. They were extremely helpful as part of our scrutiny process. And I wish you well and good morning. We will now move into private session to consider the remaining items on our agenda.